This is the quick start guide for the Apogee Cloudburst. Today we're going to show you how to set up the Cloudburst. The first thing is choosing a location. Make sure when you choose a location that it's free from obstructions that might prevent precipitation from coming into the gauge, things like trees or buildings. This location is a great location. Now that you've decided where to put your gauge, you need to put it in the ground. When you're setting your post, make sure that you use concrete so that during the operation of the precipitation gauge, it won't shift or move or go out of level. The Cloudburst has two mounting options, either a 4-inch diameter pole or a 6x6-inch wooden post. If you're going to mount using a wooden post, you can directly screw the base plate into the top of the post using lag screws. Make sure that as you set the plate, that you level it using the bubble level on the base plate. If you're going to use a 4-inch pole, make sure that you get the adapter. The adapter will allow the base plate to fit to a 4-inch pipe. I'm going to show you how you set it up using the 4-inch pipe. With the adapter screwed into the base plate, set the base plate on top of the pipe. Orient it so that the bubble level is pointing north, and with it set level, use the screws to secure it in place. With the base plate leveled and the bubble pointing north if you're in the northern hemisphere, or south if you're in the southern hemisphere, you're now ready to add the load cell. On the load cell, find where the cable is coming out of the load cell, and you want that to align with the bubble level pointing north if you're in the northern hemisphere. The holes on the bottom of the plate should align perfectly. With the load cell centered and in place, you're ready to add the cable. Run the cable through the access port, up, screw in the cord grip, and run the cable around to the load cell connector and screw it in. Make sure the cable doesn't come in contact with the outside housing. Secure the cord grip so the cord doesn't move. Now you're ready to add the cistern. Place the cistern on top of the load cell. It should center and line up with the indentation on the bottom of the cistern. Now you're ready to add fluid. It's a little bit of a process, so we're going to show you how to do that in the studio. When recharging your precipitation gauge, we recommend that you do it sometime usually in September, October, or late fall. That way, the minimal amount of antifreeze is required for the winter. We recommend using an antifreeze that has a ratio of 50-50 propylene glycol and ethanol, something like the Campbell Scientific CS705. We recommend using this kind of antifreeze because it's non-toxic and has a lower impact on the environment. When disposing of the antifreeze mixture, make sure you do so in accordance to local, state, and federal guidelines. Now for the calculations. The purpose of this equation is to determine the minimal amount of antifreeze that is required to go in the cistern for your situation. First, you need to determine what is the coldest temperature that you expect your gauge to be in. In northern Utah, the coldest temperature that we could expect would be minus 25 degrees Celsius. We can also determine that between September and January, when we expect our coldest temperature, we'll receive somewhere between 7 to 8 inches of precipitation. So we go to our chart, we take our minus 25 degrees Celsius, and we see that it's a 1 part antifreeze to 1.5 parts precipitation. To determine how much antifreeze we need to put inside the cistern, we're going to use the following equation. For a National Weather Service inlet, it's going to be this equation. So we're going to take 0.5289 times that by our expected precipitation. Then we're going to divide that by the parts per water ratio. So we take 4.2312, divide that by 1.5. So we can see that we're going to need about 2.8 inches of antifreeze in our bucket in order to prevent freezing at the coldest point next year. Keep in mind, you can always add more antifreeze if you need more protection. It just costs more money. This just gives you the minimal amount you'll need to avoid freezing. The last thing you need to do is add 400 milliliters of mineral oil on top. This will give you a 1/4 inch layer of mineral oil that will prevent evaporation from occurring. Now that you have your cistern full of antifreeze and mineral oil, you're ready to finish the install. Now the cistern's full, ready to go, it's time to remove the clips from the load cell. Squeeze the ends and pull them off. If you're going to move or transport the load cell, it's a good idea to hold on to these. Now you're ready to add the outside housing. The outside housing will slide around the outside over the top. Make sure you align the inlet with a cistern on the inside. Use the clips to secure it in place. Hook up the cable to a data logger and you're ready for another year's worth of precipitation recording. We recommend servicing your gauge in the fall. By servicing the gauge in the fall, you minimize the amount of antifreeze that is required to prevent freezing. To service the Cloudburst, remove the outside housing. With the housing removed, look around and make sure that everything is in working order. The cistern is probably going to be quite full. There's two handles on the side of the cistern to help you lift it off. So another great option is to use a siphon. Put the siphon in the cistern. And with a few squeezes, it'll begin to automatically drain. Fill up the cistern with fluid, antifreeze, and then the mineral oil on top. Now the cistern's full, ready to go, put the outside housing back on. With the outside housing back on, you're ready for another year's worth of precipitation monitoring. If you have any questions, feel free to leave them in the comment section below. Thank you so much for watching, and have a great day.